Good evening, sir. I'm in conversation with Professor Dhande at IIT Delhi at the Alumni Convention 2013. And sir has been the director for IIT Kanpur for the past 10 years. He's recently stepped down. So I want to ask you, what do you think is the vision behind a platform such as the Alumni Convention, which has been organized? What is the idea behind it? What is the vision behind it?
So for any academic institution, there are several stakeholders, the students, faculty, the society at large, like industry, the government. And now that the IIT system is more than 50 years old, it's very clear that a stakeholder called alumni is definitely an important aspect. And to develop a very healthy relationship between alumni and the institute is really the goal of such conventions. I would consider that the best model is the Israeli model. Institutions like the Weizmann Institute or the Technion University have excellent alumni network throughout the world. I think IITs are also worldwide, and therefore IIT Kanpur is trying to ensure that a very healthy network gets established through these conventions.
Okay, so there has been a lot of talk since the morning about the brand name of IIT. And especially IIT Kanpur. Also, outside of these circles, there has been a talk about the dilution of the brand name of IIT, and especially given the recent construction of several new IITs over the past few years. So what is your comment on that? Do you think the brand name of IIT is getting diluted? If yes, what are the provisions which need to be taken to keep this intact?
I fully disagree with the notion that the branding and the brand name is diluted. The brand of an academic institution gets built by scholarship, gets built by the contributions that it makes in terms of innovations, in terms of thought processes, in terms of guiding the society. And I think the society has very richly acknowledged the academic leadership of IIT, not only in India, but throughout the world. And therefore, the word branding is more of a commercial term. I think the branding of academic institution gets built up through scholarship, which has definitely not been in any way diluted. As far as the incidents, tragedies, and other aspects are concerned, the institute has been one of the most sensitive organizations. And therefore, such things are immediately attended to. And the fact that this should not happen in future, preventive measures are taken. And to some extent, these are the reflections of the complexities of the society. In our society, the stress is increasing. Cities are becoming very stressful. The students who come from the families, the family life is very stressful. So obviously, some of these things cannot be jettisoned just because you are living in IIT. So to blame IIT for something of this sort is not a very correct thing. I would say that this needs to be introspected and debated, openly discussed. And therefore, I don't agree that the branding. And since the answer is not yes, I need not answer the rest of it.
Okay. Since you mentioned about the global print of an institute such as IIT, and there was also a talk in the morning in which people said that there is a need to make an international impression now, because that is the way academic scholarship is also going to develop. There needs to be more student exchange, there has to be more faculty exchange. So where do you think IIT Kanpur specifically stands poised today with regard to other international institutes, as well as the kind of internationalization which has been there within the faculty and within the student community at IIT?
So I'm on a panel of government of Singapore, which is called International Academic Advisory Panel, and how to improve the quality of an academic institution or a system so as to improve in the rankings of the world or the global ranking. I have seen that very closely. I think almost 80% of the parameters are not applicable and we don't address them properly. So to me, globalization is extremely important, because higher education is indeed now a global agenda. Indeed, we need to take steps, but it is at the IIT Council level, or for that matter, even in some sense, the overall policy of the Government of India, that we need to make some very systemic changes. For instance, we do not allow permanent faculty positions who hold foreign nationalities. I think that needs to change. And therefore, there are some systemic changes that are required. And having seen the Singapore experience, I am pretty sure if those systemic changes are made, we will move up the ranks quite a bit. It's not the money, it's the mindset which is a problem.
Okay, that was very encouraging. Also, there was a mention in Dr. Subbarao's speech in the morning about how technology and innovation is one of the major impediments which the Indian economy faces today in meeting its goals of being a great power and whatnot. So an institute such as IIT is poised very well to meet these kind of technological impediments. But where do you think IIT stands with regard to providing technical innovative solutions to problems such as agriculture or industry and low productivity in these sectors?
So first thing is that as was mentioned in the morning, I consider India is facing stagflation. It is stagnation and inflation. Inflation, all of us understand. Stagnation, we don't understand that much. What stagnation means is that the economic vibrancy has to be maintained year after year. In order to maintain that vibrancy, the economy has to come up with new businesses, new products, new processes. Now, these new products, new processes come out of the university research. Unfortunately, this knowledge to wealth creation process is not very strong in India. And if it is weak, your economy is likely to slow down. And that is what is called as the stagnation. And that stagnation along with inflation is a very deadly combination. India is presently facing stagflation. And in order to break out of it, innovation is important. The students of IITs, the faculty of IITs have to generate patterns. They have to develop new products. They have to develop new processes. The society has to build businesses around it. And that way, the economics become very vibrant.
Often in a lot of countries, public-private partnerships with technical institutions is considered one of the major areas where the government invests so that these technological solutions can be met. Are there any of these very vibrant PPPs which are there with IIT Kanpur, or do you think that is even necessary, or what are your ideas about that?
No, according to me, PPP is a hoax. I don't think there is public and there is private. And I don't think the mix works. And particularly in India, the government and the private sector have very strong disrespect about each other. So I think academia should work with government. Academia should work with the private sector. Academia is a neutral ground where they can work with public, they can work with private, but not as a public-private partnership. I think that model is good as a coffee talk, but it has not worked. It will not work. The academia should seek support from private, and academia should seek support from government. Government has a responsibility to support academia, but this PPP is a nonsense.
Okay. I would also like to ask you, since you mentioned that, you know, you are a 360 degree alumni, having been a student, having been a faculty, having been the director. So in various of these roles, you have interacted with people, with different sets of people over a different time span. So do you think there has been a shift in aspiration of the students coming in, the aspirations and of the faculty, and how has that changed over time? Because now often we see people are saying that students from IIT, they're not interested in research, or they just want to get a fat pay package and they want to move on. Do you think that is correct? Do you think that was a scene when you were here as a student or as a faculty? So what has been the shift in aspiration over time of students in IIT?
See, ours is a very dynamic society, and ours is a very vibrant democratic society. So obviously the change is a way of life, and therefore whatever were the goals 50 years back, 40 years back, 30 years back are definitely not the same. The younger generation have got different dreams. They are exposed to different social circumstances. The middle class, which used to send the students to IITs, the level of that middle class has changed. There is a new set of economic strata which has entered into IIT. IIT indeed provides economically upward mobility, but the definition of that mobility has changed. And obviously, the academia must understand that the same old model is not going to work. So it is really a challenge to academic world as to how to reinvent themselves, how to redefine themselves in a society which is having very different economic, very different social, very different cultural composition. And to me, I am very convinced that the younger generation is very talented, very intelligent, very much interested, but the older generation has not understood them. It is the fault lies with the older generation, not with the younger generation.
Okay. With specific regard to the location of IIT Kanpur, which is way outside the city of Kanpur, and Kanpur itself is not really like a metropolis like Delhi or Bombay or Chennai. So what do you think, does that make it make the campus community a very close-knit community, and is it a strength or is it a weakness from both faculty and student point of views? Because the students often say that there's like, you know, they would prefer coming to IIT Delhi and Bombay over going to IIT Kanpur, or like placement cells are always moaning about the fact that placements aren't that great because it is Kanpur. What is your take on the specificity of Kanpur in the idea of IIT Kanpur?
So I always say jokingly that civilization ends and city of Kanpur starts, and city of Kanpur ends and IIT Kanpur starts. So having said that, and having lived in such an environment for about 40 plus years, I think seclusion is an asset for scholarship. In fact, I have seen these hustling, bustling metro towns, the peace required for a scholar is badly missing. So I consider it to be an extremely important asset that you have a certain quietness and peace when you are on a secluded campus like IIT Kanpur. So I consider that as a strength. On the other hand, the agenda, the engagement, the challenges posed to the academic community, if they are absent, then they indulge into those petty politics. So the challenge to the governance and the challenge to leadership is to continuously pose challenging intellectual assignments to the academic society called IIT Kanpur. If that doesn't happen, then all the petty issues become monstrous, and then we all get engulfed into it.
Okay, one last question probably. So there is an obvious gender gap in the number of girls, which is exemplified by the number of girls who enroll, and the number of boys, which is like monumentally large. So what do you think? It has reduced over the years, probably not that significantly. And what do you think should be done about that? And what do you think are the reasons for that?
So some of the things that are there is that our society has a certain norms. You know, coaching culture has become very predominant, and therefore parents may not want to send the girl child to the coaching classes. However, I don't think that academic planners have looked at their academic programs from gender point of view. Today, for instance, programs like architecture, international relations, finance. So IITs must create an n-dimensional academic model. Only science, and that too mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, have lost their sheen. Today, nobody gives a damn whether you are chemical or mechanical. If you want to do research, yes, go ahead and do it. But today, what is required is a very different n-dimensional academic model. If that comes in, I am sure the number of girl students will go up. The second thing is that I have seen engineering colleges have 40% of the girl student population. IITs have only 12%. So obviously there is something wrong in the admission process of IITs. To me, I have seen that the girls do extremely well in their academic programs, and we give prizes to many girl students, and I find they do very well academically. So this issue has to be solved by changing the policies. And I am sure that if IITs become n-dimensional in academic programs, we will get more students.
Okay, one last question, and that is on a much lighter note. About, so since you were a student over there, so could you share some very anecdotal things which you remember very nostalgically when you think back about your IIT days? What is the first thought which comes to you?
72-73, the mess workers went on a strike. And it was decided that the messes will not be closed, but the students will cook. And so some of us had to cook for 400 students, the rice. And so the best ever food that I have eaten in the mess is when I cooked it. And at the end of the day, I used to count the bones, and I could count all the bones in my body. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. That was Dr. Dhande and his hidden talents of cooking, apparently, which we can explore later. Anyway, thank you very much.